Well, Prime Minister Narendra Modi inaugurated the construction of the Agra Metro project in a virtual ceremony held on Monday. Following the inauguration, the Prime Minister said that the metro project worth 8,000 crore rupees will strengthen the mission related to the establishment of smart facilities in Agra. The Prime Minister said that more than 100 lakh crore rupees will be spent under the National Infrastructure Pipeline project. Work is also being done on the Multimodal Connectivity Infrastructure Master Plan. He added that efforts are on to attract investment from all over the world to improve the country's infrastructure. Meanwhile, Union Minister for Housing and Urban Affairs, Hardeep Singh Puri, in November said that COVID-19 could lead to behavioural change in urban mobility and also give an opportunity to align urban transport towards long-term development goals. With social distancing norms and other precautions in place due to the pandemic, cities are seeing a rise in transport options like cycling. The pandemic has also led to a decline in the use of public transport across the world. According to the United Nations Human Settlements Program, 90% of all reported COVID-19 cases are from urban areas, which have become the epicenter of the pandemic. In this edition of The Big Picture, we will analyze urban mobility and public transport. Joining me on the program today are Sudhir Krishna, former Union Secretary, Urban Development, Professor P.K. Sarkar, Transport Planning Expert, and Anil Srivastav, former Principal Advisor, Niti Aayog. Thank you to all my guests for joining me on this edition of The Big Picture. Mr. Krishna, let me begin the program with you first. As far as urban mobility is concerned, let's first try and analyze and understand how it has evolved and what is the status of urban mobility in our country today.
Cities are growing, and Indian urban population, which was 32% of the total population in 2001, is expected to cross 40% by the census, which will happen in the next few months' time, and go further. So therefore, we will have almost like 50 crore to 70 crore people living in cities. And you know, these and cities are not too many in number, few thousand cities. So density of population is very high in cities. Economic activities are very high in cities, and therefore people have to move more often in cities than elsewhere. And therefore, the mobility solutions are one of the prime needs of every city in the country. And now, as of now, we are dependent largely on personalized transport systems, except for a few cities. I mean, metro apart, metros are in few cities only. Even bus services are not there in many cities. Very few cities boast of, until recently. Now, of course, after the efforts of Government of India through JNNURM and subsequent programs like Amrut and other programs, some improvement is there, but still people are largely dependent on personalized transport like motorcycles and motor cars, and to some extent on walkability also. Large number of people walk also, all right. So therefore, the public transport systems, which are the essential need and which are available in a very good measure in almost all developed countries across the world, are still, you know, to be pursued very vigorously in our country. And in this effort for public transport system, metro rail appear to be most shining example, all right, because of the, you know, very unique features of metro rail systems. Otherwise, the bus-based systems are also very unique, and it will go down and down to, you know, like taxis and shared taxis and bicycles, public bicycles, walkability, etc., which are all modes of, you know, public transport or public ways move, allowing people to move safely and in a more environment friendly manner. So I think it is high time to give higher attention to public transportation system, particularly for the cities.
Absolutely. All right. So, Mr. Srivastava, let me bring you into the picture now. You know, as far as urban mobility is concerned, and we're talking about public transport too, what are the kind of measures that, you know, the government has taken in the recent past to try and ensure that we improve urban mobility?
We organized a global mobility summit in September 18, about 2 years back, which was inaugurated by the Honorable Prime Minister. And there he gave the call for the 7 C's of the mobility. Now, the 7 C's, connected, cutting edge, common, etc. So they were the points which were very essential for any mobility solution for the country and the direction in which the country's mobility should be moving forward. Now, what is happening globally? Globally, transport as a service is emerging. Mobility as a service is emerging. There is less and less emphasis on owning the vehicle or owning the means rather than owning the ride is the priority. Yes, of course, the pandemic has put a restriction or has put a roadblock to that. And the shared mobility, the way it was moving forward, it has got a little bit of a roadblock because of the pandemic, but the shared mobility is going to come. So in the urban mobility segment, there are various things which are happening globally, and India cannot be left behind, and Indian society will also be moving forward with that. Now, when we say about the mobility as a service or the transport as a service, that means that the transport is available at a call and it is there without people owning the vehicle as such. And coupled with that is the adoption or the advent of the electric mobility, which is going to play a very important role. And as it is said, the OPEX or the operating cost of vehicle is going to be very low. Nearly one-tenth of the vehicles which are operated by the diesel or the traditional fuels, whether it is the railways or whether it is the public transport, likewise. So all these things are going to play a role in evolving and in moving forward to the urban transport. Now, one thing which Dr. Krishna was saying just now, the bus density or the public transport, road public transport, which is available in our country, is one of the lowest in any developed or any big economy.
Right.
We just have about 12 to 13 buses per 1 lakh of the population. Whereas for any developed economy to have a reasonable kind of a public transport system through the rail, we must have at least 100 buses per 1 lakh of the population. Now, these are the statistics which show that we have a very long way to go. And in fact, let me tell you very frankly, we just do not have the capacities. Not even the global capacities are available to have so many buses on Indian cities to have a reasonably good kind of a public transport system.
Right.
So the country has to move forward in a long way. Metro offers a good opportunity for a shared mobility to the mass transit systems.
Hmm.
But then again, the people have to come out of the shadow of the pandemic, and then only the shared mobility would be successful.
Absolutely. All right. So since we are here then, Professor Sarkar, let's talk about some of the challenges really as far as urban mobility is concerned, and how do we address these challenges?
As you say very rightly, particularly we have been having number of challenges with respect to last mile connectivity, with respect to severe congestions on the road, with respect to pollutions, with respect to another important problem is the safety. If you look at the safety figure, road accident, it is, I think, one of the highest accident rate we have been experiencing as compared to the other countries in the world. So it's a countless, the issue, problems and issues. I think one of the important challenge we have got to face, that is how best we can develop the integrated public transport systems so as to cater maximum passengers in the public transport systems. As other panelists also have emphasized the need for a public transport systems, I feel the city has to be comprehensive mobility. The most important part is that how to connect the public transport systems with non-motorized public systems. In case two are integrated in a most efficient manner and safe manner, I think most of our problem would be solved. And one of the important things we feel nowadays, that in case when we do the road design, and it is my feeling that most of the engineering aspects appear to be faulty, and therefore we do not bother about the addressing the problem of road safety audit. So there are a number of challenges. I think it is very difficult to put forward everything in a one go. And another thing which I feel to be one of the important and utmost, without which we will not be able to attain sustainability, that is the application of intelligent transport systems. I strongly believe in our country that we have been really lagging behind in the application and development of the intelligent transport systems, which is really need of the hour. I know the NITI Aayog, some time back, they have been able to evolve the draft ITS policies. And I feel strongly that, and also have seen other countries, if the ITS architecture at the national level is not really built, we'll not be able to integrate all the other modes of transport. And our main objective is to seamless mobility, seamless connectivity, and ultimately to ensure that to everybody has the affordability to move forward in terms of making number of trips. Everybody should have the ability to have number of trips. And, and another important thing, so I believe that the number of people which are basically are not in a position to really move with because of they are disabled, they are handicapped. And right. Practically, government of India has not done much with respect to ensuring the universal accessibility. So whenever even you do the road design, the concept of universal accessibility in terms of your provision of roads where even if I am a blind person, if I have to move and cross the roads, I should have the ability to cross the road. Even I am in a wheelchair, I'll right. be able to cross the roads.
Point
so
six.
Now if you see the roads, are basically I feel ashamed when you look at the kind of design of the roads in other countries. So these are the number of challenges I can speak with on hours together. But I think that these are the real challenges we need to take up immediately. And we have to work out a strong policy towards mitigating these problems and issues.
Okay. Since we are talking about seamless mobility, Mr. Krishna, how do we ensure seamless mobility, mobility at the end of the day? Do we need an integrated approach? Do we need, an approach where, we have continuity really as far as the different modes of transport in a particular city are concerned? How do we achieve this? And also, do you believe that we need to focus on some other policy level changes like they have in Singapore, where it becomes really difficult for one family to get a second car? These kind of aspects too should be thought of, do you think?
Well, at the personal level, certain approaches are required. But let me come to the policy level issue, starting from there, because policies induce people to follow certain practices. So the first policy change, which is there already in the horizon, and there are frameworks available. It is not that I'm saying something new. And that is integrated mobility planning. See, the walk to work. So the whole system is to be designed in a way that, you ride a public transport system, but public transport system cannot touch everybody's house. You have to reach some place. You will have metro stations at an interval of, say, around about a kilometer, or even if it's a bus station, will be at about half a kilometer. There's some standards are there. Otherwise, you can't be hopping on and off every nook and corner. So therefore, from the neighborhoods, there has to be one thing is to have safe walkways. So you walk comfortably to the nearest public transport station, like bus station or like metro station. And if it is more than certain distance, for example, you cannot walk 1 kilometer every day. Some people may walk, but many elderly people and so on may not be. So it should be like, you should have small ferry services, feeder buses we call. And in Delhi, it was introduced also. I suppose it is still working well. And these small mini buses, which will go around the neighborhoods and pick up people and, of course, drop them back also and take them to the bus station where you cannot walk. And then also there should be cycle ways also. So you take your cycle and reach the metro station, and there should be proper cycle parking there. So you park the bicycle there and then go over to the place on metro and come back and take your bicycle and come back home. The second method. Third is that the metro station themselves can become a hub for multifarious activities, like, there should be shopping. There are here. I'm not saying nothing is there, but much more is possible as a policy. It has to be encouraged as shopping complexes, office spaces, and even hotels and, gyms and so on, where people go throughout the day for, their various activities. As many as can be at the metro station, or expand the metro area to a larger economic and activity area. And then so that people take the public transport, reach the metro station And within half kilometer or so, everything is there. They finish that and then take the metro and come back. So it is not good to allow things to be scattered here and there. Metro stations should become the hub of a lot of activities, supported by, as I said, feeder services. And then public bicycle system also has to be encouraged more. Again, efforts have been made. Many cities are having, but it is like token efforts only. So public bicycle systems are there so that you don't have to worry about your cycle. Because once you have taken your cycle to some place and parked there and taken a metro, then you would like to, you have to come back to that very place to take your cycle and come back. So that puts some restriction on people's desire to leave their, to take the public transport. See, public bicycle system is there. Wherever the nearest place you can leave the public bicycle, and then somewhere else you can take it and go somewhere else also. So these are something. And then, you have to have like single ticket system also. You buy one ticket, and that ticket allows you to take bus. You cover some distance in a public bus, and then you go to a metro. You don't have to take a fresh ticket. The same, like the queer card is there, and you insert the card in the metro station. You travel by metro and public bicycle place you reach, and then use the same card for public bicycle also, and so on. It comes back. And this worked so well. Kochi Metro, when they were first to integrated this fare card along with a credit card company. Delhi Metro was earlier doing it as a card for Delhi Metro only. But Kochi Metro because every metro is trying to do some innovation. Right. So Kochi Metro earned a lot of money in the process. They made an open bid with the various credit card companies and said those who want to co-brand their card with the Kochi Metro and what they will offer. And they got very good amount, which I think was in the range of something like 100 crore rupees or so. And so therefore, it is a win-all situation. You have one card, you don't waste time buying tickets, and this is a wonderful solutions are there. So urban mobility has to be planned. Then if you do all that, then people will not use their vehicle. But if things are not well in place, then people are forced to use their personal transport just for the sake of lack of a better alternative.
Right.
That's
all. Right.
Yeah.
Okay. So Mr. Srivastav, at some level, do you also believe that it's we need a change in mentality as well, because driving around in our country especially has become so inconvenient for people, that it becomes a bit of an inconvenience really as far as taking the public transport is concerned. So at some level, better awareness and also a change in mindset.
The change in mindset is already taking place. It is yet to percolate down from the metros or from the bigger towns to the smaller towns, but people are realizing the importance of manual transport systems, which are non-motorized. In India, we have a very large proportion of non-motorized transport. In fact, it is nearly 45% that our travel is non-motorized in India, which is very different from the other developed and bigger economies. Our average trip size is also less than 5 kilometers in India, which is also very small compared to, again, the developed countries and the bigger economies. So Indian mobility is different. We are attuned to sharing the mobility. We are attuned to sharing our bullock cart. We are attuned to sharing our vehicles. So all this is playing a role, and that a change in mindset is already taking place. There are so many startups are coming up, as Sudhir Krishnaji was saying, to connect the metro stations for the last mile connectivity and for the first mile connectivity. There are at least 20 to 25 new startups which are playing a very important and significant role in metro towns, and they would be percolating down to the smaller cities. And the government, Ministry of Housing has already worked on a common mobility card, which is very critical for our mobility, but the idea is to have one card in the entire country. I mean, it's a very difficult task, but it has been achieved, more or less it has been achieved, and it was launched in the sense that the idea was launched by the Prime Minister, and the card would be coming into the practice very shortly. There are already a few metros and public transport entities who have been integrated, and they are having the common mobility card. But for the entire country to have an intermodal common mobility card, national, which is called NCMS, is a very excellent idea, and it is likely to be there very shortly, which will integrate the railways, the air travel, the public transport system, of the road, and then also connecting it even with the ferries wherever they are, and likewise. So all these things are there, and it is certainly adding up to the change in the mindset, and the youngsters in the country and the young population is already aware of it. Mm. You see, the statistics about the automobile sales. Now, automobile sales are predicted to be going down globally. That's a big call which the manufacturers have to take. The automobile right. manufacturers have to look into it as to how to handle this challenge from the transport as a service, wherein the people would like to own the ride, would like to travel from point to point A to point B, rather than owning a vehicle to travel from point A to point B. So this mindset is very well changing, and this pandemic, the lockdown has also given a lot of awareness about the clean environment. People would be shifting towards, as I look at it, from the traditional fuel-based mobility solutions to the clean energy mobility solutions. And sure. that also is reflected by the spurt in the sales of the electric two-wheelers. The people, mm. those who are buying two-wheelers, they are trying to move forward toward the electric two-wheelers. The only challenge is that of the charging stations and the charging right. Infrastructure. And as soon as it comes through, the people would be moving forward to the clean energy mobility also. Sure. So these are the changes which are happening all across the country.
Absolutely. Professor, as far as infrastructure is concerned, you know, what needs to be done on that front?
I think it's really a big challenge, and our Prime Minister, Honorable Prime Minister, he's basically very much committed towards improving the infrastructure to a great extent. I'm also happy we see the initiative for going for innovative transport systems, as other panelists